Today we'll be talking on another topic, that is incontinence, or we call urinary incontinence. We'll be talking under the headings of definition, etiology, pathophysiology, clinical features, investigations, differential diagnosis, treatment and complications. Before we come to incontinence, what is continence? Continence means ability to pass urine or feces voluntarily in a socially acceptable pace, which can be urinary or can be bowel. Person will recognize the need, will identify the correct place, will hold on until he reaches the correct place, and passes urine or feces when he gets there. Incontinence means involuntary loss of urine, which is objectively demonstrable and is social and hygienically problem. That we call as the incontinence. Or we call unable to retain natural discharge or evacuation of urine or feces. So urinary incontinence means it is an involuntary loss of urine that is objectively demonstrable and a social and hygienic problem. Overactive bladder is a variety of incontinence where person has got urinary urgency with or without urge incontinence. Usually it is associated with frequency and nocturia. Now there are different terminology which are being utilized. One is called urge incontinence, where person will have a strong urge to void immediately with or without increased frequency, and it is very common in overactive bladder. And whenever the person has got urge incontinence, we call it as a overactive bladder weight variety. It is also called as a detrusal instability, or we call urge urinary incontinence. There is another variety we call stress incontinence, or it is called generalized stress incontinence. Whenever there is an increased intra-abdominal pressure, it will lead to incontinence. The third variety we call as overflow incontinence, or we call as a false incontinence, or it is also called as isturia paradoxica, where over-distended bladder leads to overflow dribbling, we call as overflow incontinence. Functional incontinence means physical or psychological impairment leads to inability to get to a bathroom, and that leads to an incontinence we call as a functional incontinence. Mixed variety is usually a combination of two, where usually it is a urge incontinence plus stress incontinence, which is very, very common in overactive bladder, which is quite common in overactive bladder. We call it as a true incontinence, or we call it as a pseudo incontinence or a false incontinence, which is overflow incontinence. And true incontinence is also called as a continuous incontinence, which is very commonly because of a genetic anomaly like fistula. Pseudo incontinence or false incontinence is also called as a isturia paradoxica. Acute is also called transient or reversible, where person will have an incontinence for a short period and it will recover on its own. While established variety, which remains for a longer period, is called as a chronic incontinence. There is another group we call as a nocturnal anuresis, where ideally person is not having incontinence, but he will have a complete evacuation of bladder during night. So true incontinence is called as a continuous incontinence. The commonest cause of that is urinary fistula, as vasico-vaginal fistula or ectopia vasica. False incontinence or overflow incontinence, or we call it a isturia paradoxica, which is very commonly in diabetes, neurogenic bladder, genital prolapse, and post-surgical obstructions, where because of overflow, there is an overflow dribbling, which is called overflow incontinence. And this is because of over-distension of bladder. There is one terminology which is utilized, is called the urodynamic stress incontinence, where involuntary leakage of urine occurs because of increased abdominal pressure in the absence of detrusor muscle contraction. This can be demonstrable by urodynamic study. The causes of transient incontinence, we call DIPER, D for delirium, I for infection of urinary tract, A for atrophic vaginitis or urethritis, P for pharmacological agents, or we call drugs, that is anticholinergic drugs, sedatives, alcohol, analgesics, diuretics, muscle relaxant, adrenergic agents. Another P for psychological factors like depression or regression. E for excessive urine production like diabetes insipidus, diabetes mellitus, or increased intake of water like polydipsia. Restricted activity, and S for stool impaction. There is another terminology which is used called DRIP, D for drugs and delirium, R for restricted mobility and retention, I for infection, impaction, inflammation, inflammation like atrophic urethritis or vaginitis, and P for polyuretic state like congestive heart failure, diabetes mellitus, or hypercalcemia. Usually, transient incontinence is acute and reversible. There is an overflow incontinence which is usually because of an obstruction like blocked urethra, bladder weakness, diabetes, alcohol, increased size of prostate, or we call it the BPH, benign prostatic hypertrophy, etc. There are three common variety of incontinence: stress incontinence, which accounts for nearly 50% of the cases; urge incontinence accounts for 20% of the cases; but mixed variety, which accounts for 30%. So indirectly, stress incontinence accounts for a major group, and we'll be discussing more on a stress incontinence. The etiology of stress incontinence, very commonly it is because of congenital weakness of internal urethral sphincters and congenital defects like epispadias, short urethra, wide bladder neck, and separation of pubic symphysis. Another etiology is trauma to the bladder during vaginal delivery or vaginal surgery, or another very common cause is episiotomy. In a menopausal age, it is quite common. During pregnancy, there will be damage to the sphincters, particularly pelvic floor, we call as an extrinsic sphincter. It is also very common with genital prolapse, and you can have a nervous disease like multiple sclerosis, which can produce a damage to the spinal cord and produce problems. Urethral hypermobility like urogenital prolapse, pelvic floor damage during pelvic surgery, during delivery and menopause, urethral scarring like vaginal surgery or incontinence surgery, radiotherapy or recurrent UTI, raised intra-abdominal pressure, pregnancy, chronic cough, abdominal mass, obesity, ascites. You can classify into two big groups, urethral and extra-urethral groups. And these are some of the conditions which can produce urethral etiology or extra-urethral etiology. The risk factors will include change in detrusor muscle control like overactive bladder or decreased bladder capacity, decreased urinary flow rates, decreased renal clearance, change in the fluid balance, certain medications, comorbid condition like congestive heart failure, diabetes, depression, or CNS damage, obesity, vaginal delivery, episiotomy, diabetes, stroke, estrogen depletion, radiation, etc. If we go through a pathophysiology, it is very commonly because of the weakness of the internal sphincter or descent of a bladder neck below the level of the pelvic floor. And this is the diagram which shows you urethral incontinence and mixed incontinence, how it is being produced. In case of an acute, it is usually a temporary. In case of an urge incontinence, it is because of a detrusal hyperreflexia, or we call detrusal instability. In case of a stress incontinence, it is because of the weakness in the sphincter, particularly internal sphincter and external sphincters. Overflow is because of the obstruction, and following an obstruction, there is an overflow dribbling. In a mixed variety, it is a common combination of urge and stress incontinence. Functional is usually because of the cognitive impairment and a physical impairment, and absolutely rare, which is because of a congenital anomaly like extra urethral fistula, and sometimes in a case of a spinal cord injury. The four common varieties of incontinence, stress incontinence, is mainly because of the decrease in pressure, which is outside. And whenever there is an increased pressure from outside the bladder, we call as an intra-abdominal pressure. This increased intra-abdominal pressure will produce contraction of the detrusal muscle, and there is a weakness in the pelvic floor, which is producing decreased tone in the internal sphincters or external sphincter. Pelvic floor, when it is affected, it will involve external sphincter, and will produce incontinence. In case of an urge incontinence, there is involuntary contraction of the bladder because of the irritation of the bladder wall, which will produce incontinence. In both this variety, there will be partial evacuation, which will result into residual urine volume. In case of an overflow incontinence, it will be because of the blockage at the vesico-urethral junction, there will be overflow dribbling. In a neurogenic variety, because there is a obstruction at the level of the bladder neck, there will be impaired functioning of the neurons, which will produce neurogenic incontinence. The basic pathophysiology of urethral incontinence is because of the urethral hypermotility, which is almost in 80 to 90% of the patient, while intrinsic sphincter dysfunction is only in 10 to 20% of patient. The presentation is very commonly either a continuous in case of a congenital anomalies like fistula, and in case of a overflow, retention with overflow, dribbling, that is we call as a false incontinence or hysteria paradoxica. Acute incontinence is usually transient and reversible, while established is a long term, and it is chronic group, where you will have urge incontinence, stress incontinence, mix, overflow, or functional incontinence. The symptoms very commonly are incontinence, overactive bladder symptoms, and voiding difficulties. In case of a stress incontinence, usually person will have incontinence along with cough, sneezing, laughing, lifting heavy objects, vigorous exercise, after sexual intercourse, standing in a prolonged time, etc. All this condition will increase the intra-abdominal pressure and will result into incontinence. This is also called as a genuine stress incontinence, or it is also called as a sphincter incontinence. You can have two varieties, type 1, type 2. Type 1 is a complete loss of a posterior urethrovesical angle, and in a type 2, there is a complete loss of posterior vesico-urethral angle together with increased angle between urethra and vertical line to be more than 30 degrees. This will lead to severe stress incontinence. Degree wise, it can divide into grade 1, grade 2, grade 3. In grade 1, incontinence will occur only with severe stress, such as coughing or sneezing. Grade 2, incontinence will occur with a moderate stress like rapid movement, walking up and down the staircase. and a grade 3 will happen with a minimal stress, or we call a mild stress, such as even in standing posture, even without coughing or sneezing, and patient will be continent in a supine posture. Urge incontinence usually will occur with frequent urination in a day and night time, sudden urination with urinary urgency. This is very common in case of overactive bladder. And overflow incontinence is very common with a retention. Bladder never feels empty, inability to void when the urge is felt, and small quantity of urine will dribble out in the form of a drops even after voiding. Now, this is the difference between stress, urge, and overflow. Incontinence episodes will, in a case of a stress, there will be loss of urine with Valsalva maneuver. In a case of a urge, there will be person will have urgency and will not be able to reach the toilet. While in a case of a overflow, it is a continuous slow loss in the form of overflow dribbling. The triggering factor in a stress, cough, physical activity, sneezing, straining, Valsalva maneuver, etc. In a case of a urge, full bladder and there is a sensory triggers. While in case of overflow, you don't require any particular triggers. Frequency in a stress, usually it is normal. In urge, person goes frequently to the bathroom, so there is increased frequency. In a overflow, there is hesitancy and person finds inability to void urine. Nocturia will be less than once in a stress incontinence, while it will be more in case of an urge incontinence. And in an overflow, person will have anuresis. Volume of urine lost in a stress is a very small quantity, while in a case of an urge, large quantity is lost because a person voids out a good quantity of urine. While in an overflow, there is only continuous dribbling, so there is a large quantity of urine retained in bladder. For evaluation, there are different steps. That is called as a step 1, rule out transient causes, get a bladder diary, direct history and physical examination. Step 4, make a diagnosis based on history, physical examination, PVR examination and knowledge of urinary incontinence. These are all the different types of investigation which are being done on an outpatient, urodynamic studies and specialized studies. Mainly you do a midstream urine sample examination, frequent volume charts, frequency and volume charts, that is we call urinary diary, PET test, in a urodynamic study, uroflowmetry, cystometry and video cystourethrography. In a specialized test, urethral pressure profilometry, cystourethroscopy, ultrasonography, cystourethrography, IV urography, EMG and ambulatory urodynamics. These are all the different type of tests which are being done to identify the type of incontinence and to also find out the severity of incontinence, and also it will help to identify the type of incontinence. Midstream sample examination will help to identify urinary tract infection, diabetes, diabetes mellitus, diabetes insipidus, etc. PET test will help you to identify presence of urinary incontinence is present or not. Sacral reflex will help you to differentiate neurogenic etiology. Q-tip test will also help you to identify the weakness in a pelvic floor. Uroflowmetry, it gives a very good idea to exclude the presence of an outflow obstruction or a hypotonic bladder. Cystometry will help you to differentiate between stress incontinence and overactive bladder. And when you do a subtracted cystometry, it will help you to identify good number of conditions like stress incontinence differentiating from others. It will rule out stress incontinence. Video cystourethrography will help you to identify different conditions and different types of incontinence. And also it will help you to identify vesicoureteral reflux, diverticulum, fistulas, leakage, etc. urethral pressure studies will help you to identify the urethral disorders. Cystourethrography, urethroscopy will help you to identify the different conditions of bladder which results into incontinence. And IV urography will help you to identify the function of kidney, and also in case of a hematuria with recurrent hematuria and recurrent UTI to find out whether they are present or not and if there is a voiding difficulty. Electromyography will help you to identify the neurological disorders. Ambulatory urodynamic study will help you to identify the severity of stress incontinence. This is a diagram which shows you the initial management of a urinary incontinence, particularly in a woman, where you take a good history, followed by a clinical assessment, followed by a presumptive diagnosis, and then you decide regarding a management. So this is the way usually we follow. So first you take a good history, make your clinical assessment by doing a good physical examination, and then you put a diagnosis whether it is stress incontinence, mixed incontinence, or overflow incontinence, or it is an obstructive element, urge incontinence in case of an overactive bladder, etc. Then the treatment usually is a lifestyle modification, pelvic floor exercise, bladder training, and then you can use pharmacotherapy. And when that does not work, then you can go for a specialized treatment like surgical interventions. Usually conservative treatment is preferred, followed by pharmacotherapy, and last is surgery. So usually lifestyle modification, followed by medication, followed by surgery. In a lifestyle modification, weight loss, dietary changes like alcohol, stop taking alcohol, beverages, avoid tea, coffee, with or without caffeine, citrus fruits, chocolate, spicy foods, artificial sweeteners, etc. should be avoided. Pelvic floor exercises, electrical stimulation of pelvic floor, estrogen replacement therapy, pessary, and if that does not work, usually surgery is indicated. In surgery, urethropexy, sling surgery, and tension-free vaginal taps. These are some of the procedures which are usually being approved, and 80 to 90% cure rates are there for minimum 5 years period. These are list of a surgical intervention which can be done via vaginals or by abdomen or by laparoscopic, or you can have a combination of two, and sometime you can go for a complex surgery. The most common surgery preferred is urethroplasty, then followed by urethropexy, colpo suspension, urethral sling, and tension-free vaginal taps. In case of a functional incontinence, behavior modification, bladder training, rarely person requires a surgical intervention, absorbent pads, diligent skin cares, and indwelling catheters is one of the treatment. Usually the person who develops a incontinence will have some of the common complications, like medical complications, like because of continuous incontinence, rash, pressure ulcer, recurrent UTI, might get a falls, and because of falls have a fractures. As far as the psychosocial complication is concerned, they feel embarrassment, there's a stigma, usually person gets isolated, psychological disturbances like depression, and sometimes even they require institutional risk factors. So psychological factors and recurrent UTI are the most common. Here we end a lecture on stress incontinence, or we call as a urinary incontinence.